Welcome to the May 9th worship of the Stanton Church of the Brethren in this video format. This is a day that has been designated by society to honor mothers. As I noted in my article in a recent newsletter, I tend to be kind of cynical, thinking that this day was created primarily for the benefit of the card, candy, and flower industries. Yet it's also a day in which the Christian community can consider the qualities that are found in a godly mother. And I want to work at doing so in this worship by considering a rather strange incident recorded in the Old Testament book of 1 Kings. Youth Sunday is going to be observed next Sunday. The youth, under the leadership of Amy Farthing, will be planning and leading our worship. And then the following Sunday, May 23rd, will be Pentecost, and we will be observing that important observance on the Christian calendar. My name is J.D. Glick, and I am serving as the interim pastor of this congregation. Again, I'd like to thank those who are assisting in the recording of this worship today. Our worship leader is Hannah Simmons. Hymn director is David McMillan. David, along with Mark Lane, will be sharing special music. Our organist is Galen Hevner. Videoing our service is Mark Lane. And in the sound booth is Frank Allman. I invite you now to give your attention to the call to worship, which Hannah and I will read responsibly.
In the Old Testament book of 1 Kings, we find a strange story which begins, "One day, two prostitutes came and presented themselves before King Solomon."
In our worship, we present ourselves before the divine authority called God.
The two women sought the wisdom of the king in resolving an argument regarding who was the real mother of a baby.
This morning, we seek an understanding of truth and justice as we study the scriptures.
When King Solomon proposed settling the disagreement by cutting the baby in two and giving each woman half of it, the identity of the real mother became evident for her willing to resake her claim on the child by pleading for his life.
We celebrate the example of this loving mother who was more concerned about the well-being of her child than she was in being and satisfying her own selfish desires.
Mother's Day, a blessing and a tribute to all mothers. Blessed be all mothers who have come into our lives, ones who have birthed us and ones who each gave to be a part of us, whose kindness, care, and loving remain with us to guide, to remain with us who we are and who you taught us to be. You inspire us. Make us strive in every way, through the hard paths and the easy ones, through the falls and the climbs, through the skips and the hops. Especially know and remember, mothers, you help us make our day. Mothers, this little tribute flows directly from the heart. You are loved and cherished, and valuable, one and all of who you are.
Our opening hymn this morning is number 89, "For the Beauty of the Earth." We will sing verses 1, 4, and 5.
For the beauty of the earth, for the
For today's scripture reading from 1 Kings 3, chapters 16 through 28. The real mother, her heart full of love for her son, said to the king, "Please, your majesty, don't kill the child. Give it to her." Then Solomon said, "Don't kill the child. Give it to the first one, mother, woman, for she is the real mother."
A fable brought from Vietnam by missionaries recounts a little boy walking along a path who comes to a cage with a tiger in sight. The tiger says to the boy, "Little boy, please open the door of the cage. I'm hungry and I can't get any food while as long as I am inside this cage." The boy answers, "No, if I open the door, you will eat me." That's what tigers do with little boys they find in the forest. The tiger promises not to eat the little boy and again pleads for him to let him out of the cage because he's hungry. So, believing the dubious promise of the tiger and out of kindness, the boy opens the door of the cage. And sure enough, the tiger jumps on the boy prepared to eat him. The little boy reminds the tiger that he had promised not to eat the boy, even though doing so is a part of his character. The tiger gets off the boy and proposes that the two of them find three wise creatures and ask them if the nature of tigers is really to eat human beings. So the tiger and the boy begin walking together. They first come to a water buffalo who listens to their stories. And the water buffalo thinks for a moment and then reasons this way. The man works the water buffalo very hard in the field, and when the water buffalo gets old and is no longer useful in the fields, the man kills and eats the water buffalo. I say yes, it appears that the way of the tiger is to eat persons. So the tiger jumps on the little boy, ready to eat him, but the boy again reminds the tiger that he had proposed that they talk to three wise creatures. So the tiger agrees to continue the survey. The two of them walk along until they come to a chicken. The chicken listens to the stories of the tiger and the little boy, and the question, is it the way of the tiger to eat persons? The chicken answers this way, "I lay my eggs, which are collected by my owner who feeds me, until I get old and am no longer able to lay eggs, and then the man kills me and eats me. Yes, I presume that the way of the tiger is to eat persons." Again, the tiger jumps on the little boy, ready to have a meal, when the boy reminds him that they have not yet talked to three wise creatures. So they continue their walk together. The two come to an old man. The old man listens to their stories and the crucial question, is the way of the tiger to eat persons? The old man scratches his head and invites the tiger and the boy to take a walk with him. The man says, "Where did you say all of this happened?" "Oh, over there in that cage," the tiger points. So the three of them walk over to the cage. And the old man asks for more clarification. "Tiger, were you inside or outside of the cage? I don't understand." And the tiger jumps in the cage to demonstrate his location. And the old man observes, "I see that you are inside the cage, but I still do not fully understand. Was the door open or closed?" The tiger slams the door shut and announces it was closed just like this. And the old man quickly locks the cage with the tiger inside, thus saving the life of the little boy. The old man then says to the boy, "Son, today you have hopefully learned an important lesson. It's wonderful to be kind, but you also have to be wise." Wisdom and kindness are the qualities demonstrated by King Solomon in the scripture that we are looking at this morning. In this curious Old Testament passage from 1 Kings, we find the story of two prostitutes who are living together. Both of them have given birth to a son within days of one another. And while they are sleeping one night, one of the mothers inadvertently rolls over on her infant son and smothers him. Desperately wanting to have a child, this prostitute switches her dead baby with the other woman's living child. When the other woman awakens in the morning and prepares to nurse her son, she notices that the child lying by her side is dead. Upon further examination, the second woman determines that the dead infant is really not her offspring. The two women get into an argument, both claiming that they are the mother of the living child. Unable to resolve their disagreement, the women take their case to King Solomon, who is known for his wisdom. The scripture is clear that the two women were living together with no one else in the house to serve as a witness. And clearly, that was a day prior to DNA testing, which would have clearly determined which prostitute, of course, was the right mother. So how would King Solomon resolve this argument by deciding which of the two women is telling the truth? To which mother does the living child really belong? Using insightful wisdom in deciding this case, Solomon asks for a sword and orders that the living child will be cut in two so that one half of the child can be given to each mother. The two mothers react in very different ways to the king's proposal to cut the living child in half. The first mother agrees to the proposed resolution to the dispute. She reasons, "If I can't have the baby, then neither can the other woman. Go ahead and cut the baby in half so that we can divide him." On the other hand, the second mother pleads, No. Don't kill the child. Go ahead and let her have him." Now, what was it in the contrasting responses of these two women which revealed to King Solomon which of the two was the real mother? The wise king can see that the pretend mother really doesn't care about the living child in accepting his proposal that the child be cut in half. While on the other hand, the real mother is willing to give up her claim, her selfish claim, for the sake of the child. The real mother is more concerned about the well-being of the child and pleads for his life than in satisfying her own selfish desire. So King Solomon orders the child to be given to the mother who is willing to make the sacrifice in order to save the life of the child. Now, yes, I acknowledge that this is a very strange scripture to use on Mother's Day. It's certainly not the kind of sweet story that we like to hear on this day when we honor mothers. Cutting a baby in half is a rather gruesome scene. Yet I use this biblical account because I think the story points to a very important quality of motherhood, yes, of fatherhood, for that matter. As King Solomon is faced with deciding which is the pretend mother and which is the real one, he is wise enough to understand a parent's compassion puts the well-being of the child above one's own. In one of the Chicken Soup for the Soul books, Barbara Goodrich recounts that anyone who would meet her father would first of all notice how good-looking he is. The next thing persons would notice would be his hands. He is a professional carpenter, and so usually he's got a bruised finger or two, fingernail or two, several fresh cuts and calluses. The girth of his fingers are three times the size of an average man's finger. They are the hands of a working man who started working at the young age of three, milking cows on the family farm. 23 years previous to her writing, the author's mother had died, and this man's man was left to raise alone a 14-year-old girl and an 11-year-old boy. He suddenly became both mom and dad. This, in the beginning, was made easier because the daughter was pretty much a tomboy who frankly preferred playing with boys, doing things like climbing trees, building forts, playing football and baseball, and playing with G.I. Joe figures. Oh yeah, she did have a Barbie doll, but she tended to dress the Barbie doll in G.I. Joe fatigues. She even, when young, played on an all-boys ice hockey team. None of these boyish activities prepared her for stepping into womanhood. The author reports that she especially remembers a trip when she was 15 years old to visit her aunt in Georgia. As they were traveling, for some reason, everything her dad and her father did or said upset her. She went from crying to laughing for no apparent reason. She just wanted to be left alone. That evening, the small family stopped at a motel to spend the night. Once they were checked into the room, her dad sent her brother out to get some sodas. While the brother was gone, her father asked her what was wrong. The girl admitted that she was having her first menstruation period. She burst out crying uncontrollably. While there is no instruction booklet which comes with parenting, her father somehow knew the right thing to do was to hold her daughter and to let her mourn the loss of her childhood. He even went to the store to buy the items that she needed. The author notes that that night, that evening, they both crossed some kind of bridge, she into womanhood and he more deeply into the role of being mother as well as father. It was a couple of years later when her senior prom rolled around and she found herself in the happy position of, at the time, dating a boy who went to a neighboring high school. They each invited each other to the other's prom that were held on consecutive nights. The father made sure that his daughter had the perfect dress, a dress that would make her feel like a princess. The dad seemed especially pleased that his daughter was stepping out of her tomboyish image and acting like a young woman, even if it was only for a couple of nights. She got home from the dance early in the morning hours to get a few hours sleep before needing to drive to her boyfriend's parents' house to attend the prom the next evening. She was completely amazed when she came downstairs on that Saturday morning to find that her father had already hand-washed and hand-pressed her beautiful prom dress, making it look like new for another night's festivities. The author closes this account by suggesting her heart was very much warmed when she thinks of her father with his large, callous hands washing her delicate prom dress as an act of unconditional love. Today we celebrate mothers, while at the same time affirming the important role played by fathers. But again, I think what we learn from this strange Old Testament story that demonstrates both wisdom and kindness is that it points to the critical quality of being a parent, which is their unconditional love. In other words, to be more concerned about the well-being of his or her child than in having one's own selfish desires satisfied. Amen.
So I remember last year at this time thinking, you know, what am I going to do for Mother's Day? And I was able to find something new and interesting, and I was able to do the same thing today. This song was written by Malcolm Gordon, a Canadian, and it's used by permission, and it's called Mothers of Faith. For our mothers of faith, for our sisters in Christ, for our daughters of God, we will praise. For their courage and care, their compassion and tears, for their unending prayers, we will praise. For the women who carried and bore us now, our song we raise. For the wisdom and ways so inspire us now, our God. For the unmarried bride and her miracle child come to save. For the barren of womb and poured out perfume and the watch at the tomb we will praise. For the women who carried and bore us now, our song we raise. For the wisdom and ways so inspire us now, our God. Pain we confess, for the gifts we return, for the saints we have spurned, from the blindness we turn and are blessed. For the women who carried and bore us now, this song we raise. For the wisdom and ways so inspire us now, our God. So inspire us now, our God we praise. For our mothers of faith, for our sisters in Christ, for the daughters of God we will praise. To our Father above, with a mother in love, won't you lead us in freedom and grace.
This week, in going through my files, I came across in one of my files a little thing that I cut out of a newspaper. Many, many years ago, the paper has darkened and the Scotch tape that I used to hold it together is turned yellow. But it was a column of Dear Abby, Abigail Van Buren, a parent's prayer. And she credits it to having been written by Gary Myers, the co-founder of a monthly children's magazine that has been published for decades called Highlights for Children. I would like to use it as our prayer this morning, a parent's prayer. Oh, Heavenly Father, make me a better parent. Help me to understand my children, to listen patiently to what they have to say, and to answer all their questions kindly. Keep me from interrupting them, talking back to them, and contradicting them. Make me as courteous to them as I would have them be to me. Give me the courage to confess my sins against my children and to ask of them forgiveness when I know that I have done wrong. May I not vainly hurt the feelings of my children. Forbid that I should laugh at their mistakes or resort to shame and ridicule as punishment. Let me not tempt a child to lie or steal. So guide me hour by hour that I may demonstrate by all I say and do that honesty produces happiness. Reduce, I pray, the meanness in me. May I cease to nag. And when I'm out of sorts, help me, O Lord, to hold my tongue. Blind me to the little errors of my children and help me to see the good things that they do. Give me a ready word for honest praise. Help me to treat my children as those of their own age, and let me not exact of them the judgments and conventions of adults. Allow me not to rob them of the opportunity to wait upon themselves, to think, to choose, and to make their own decisions. Forbid that I should ever punish them for my selfish satisfaction. May I grant them all their wishes that are reasonable and have the courage to always withdraw a privilege which I know will do them harm. Make me so fair and just, so considerate and compassionable to my children that they will have a genuine esteem of me. Fit me to be loved and imitated by my children. With all these gifts, O God, do give me calm and poise and self-control. Amen.
Our closing hymn is number 362, Help Us to Help Each Other.
Thank you.
Having worshiped this day on a day designed to honor mothers, and having heard a biblical story in which King Solomon identified a crucial quality of true motherhood, let us go now as mothers and fathers, as grandmothers and grandfathers, as aunts and uncles, as sons and daughters, yes, as any member of a family, indeed a member of the human family, in the awareness that the godly way to be more concerned about the well-being of others than in satisfying one's own selfish desires. That is the way of God. Amen.